If I ever had a video blog as opposed to a podcast, it would look something like this, a black screen like the screen you're looking at right now. So I was thinking about the bad stuff that I do and specifically the bad code that I write. So I thought I would think about it more, and I actually came up with something that is quite neat, or well, I think it is anyway. So let me think of some of the bad things I do. Bad things. My handwriting is terrible. Bad things in C++, because I write well, I write some C sharp as well, but I do bad things in C++. And there are three things, if I could learn to draw as well, there are three things that I'm doing which are particularly bad. One is I make God objects. Essentially, the idea of a God object is instead of a normal class that subsequently gets subclassed by extended functionality and turned into a hierarchy, what we end up doing is we end up doing a class that's massive. I mean, really huge. And so it takes up lots of memory, and it's generally considered a bad thing. And I make lots of these God objects. The second thing I do is this isn't bad, this is just inefficient, is pass by value. And the third thing I do is use the stack. I use the stack and not the heap. And not the heap. So all of these are bad practices, but let me explain why I do it, because it's kind of relevant to what I want to talk about. So the first thing is, why do I have God objects instead of an inheritance hierarchy where things are compartmentalized, shall we say? Well, let's imagine, for example, that you're modeling, I don't know, a card game. So if you're an object-oriented programmer, like I'm not, then you might have, I don't know, you might have a class called card. So you have a class called card, and you would have some of the fundamental properties related to, let's say, a card game. And then somewhere down the line, you might have something like a calculation for the value of a card. So you would typically do, I don't know, virtual int value, pure virtual function. So you have a base class called card, and then you have classes for, like, I don't know, creatures. So you would have a creature which inherits from card, and this is the accepted way of doing things. So when you have a database of these cards, you manufacture creatures, or you might have, I don't know, a spell with the same stuff, and you would have something here between the curly braces to specialize, so you would maybe have more fields regarding these types. And this is a very good idea. Unfortunately, it doesn't work. At least it doesn't work for me. Here is why. So first of all, imagine you're doing this, and suddenly you decide to put you make a deck of those cards. So you manufacture effectively a you make a class, let's say a class called deck. And so you decide to inherit from a vector of cards. Vector of cards. Or you might just instantiate a vector of cards. I don't know. It doesn't matter. The problem is this is impossible. This is impossible. Unfortunately, it's totally unrealistic. The reason it's unrealistic is because this is a kind of value storage. Value storage. So effectively, this vector is hoping to store cards. Unfortunately, a card is cannot be instantiated because it has a pure virtual member. So you cannot write card C, for example. It's impossible. And unfortunately, you cannot store them like this because this whole thing is not polymorphic. So here's the thing, if you were in C sharp, for example, what you could do is you could make an abstract. Well, no, yeah, you could actually make an abstract class. You could make an abstract class, a card that would then have, an abstract member and whatever, and you could make a list of cards. And this would be a polymorphic structure. Unfortunately, you cannot do it like this. So what can you do? Well, there are a couple of things that you can do in C++. So one of those things is, of course, to use a pointer. So instead of a vector card, you have a vector of card pointers. Card pointers, like so. All right, so why is this a problem? Well, it's a problem for many reasons. One of those is that you suddenly have to manage the memory. So essentially what would happen is if you, let's just finish this. So we have, let's do a struct. So you have a struct called deck, which inherits from vector of card pointers. What you have to do when you're actually filling in the deck is if you have some method, let's say void foo, if you have a method, then you cannot do this. You cannot make a card C and then say, deck D and then, you know, D dot push back. Well, let's imagine that D is somewhere outside. So let's imagine that the deck declaration is here, and you do D dot push back card. Unfortunately, as soon as you leave, as soon as you hit this point, the card object gets cleaned up, it gets removed, and so you just send a pointer into a vector to something that doesn't exist. So next up, of course, we have even smarter people who come around and say, well, of course you shouldn't do it this way. You should have smart pointers. So you should have a vector of shared PTR of cards. Like so. And I think there is also a boost base class that does the same thing. Maybe PTR vector or something. PTR vector. I can't remember now. So it gets somewhat simpler in this regard, because then what you do is at this point, somewhere here, you make a shared PTR of a card. And so actually, yeah, you use something like make shed. You make a pointer and you add it to the list. And this may seem to be fine, but the problem is, and I guess it has to be reiterated, that one of the things I do generally is I pass by value, and I store everything by value. Now you're probably wondering why on earth that is. I mean, why can't we have, you know, proper heap allocations everywhere? Why do things have to be on the stack? So here is why. Okay, so let's imagine you're simulating a card game. So you have a game. This has a set of players. Let's say player one and player two. Each player has a deck. They have a set of cards in, I don't know, well, they might have like a hero that they're controlling and so on. So the second player has those same things. And then there is also the board where the game takes place. And that board has lots of data on the game states and so on. And there's lots of other stuff as well that I'm not going to mention. So if you're typically writing, let's say, a simulation, so you want to implement the process this game follows, then it goes something like this. So what you do at each turn to simulate the game is, let's say you have some turn one, for example, then for the current player, so you have game and player info, and you list out all the possible actions at step one. So at step one, you could have lots of different cards that can be played and so on. So there's like A, we'll use the letter A to indicate the possibilities. And then of course, on that same turn, so we're still in turn one, on that same turn, you might have a set of further steps. So that would have an additional B possible steps. So effectively, what we end up having, and this goes on forever, you might have several different steps. And sometimes those steps are quite evolved. For example, you might have movement in a grid. So you might have a grid where cards can be moved, and a card can move in some direction, and you get like 8 different directions that the card can move. Plus, you get the possibility of playing a few different cards, and so it kind of it really fans out. So it's whatever many steps you take. So effectively, what we have to do is if we're simulating the process, is we have to simulate a chain. Let's say A1, B1, C1, D1. We have to simulate a rather large chain of these events, and it becomes a kind of a stochastic, effectively, simulation of things that, well, it depends on the sample space, but typically the number of steps you have to simulate is A times B times C times D times, and so on. And this is very large, very large. Okay, so how does this work? Let's suppose you have the context of the whole game stored in an object. What you have to do then is you have to apply some action that would result in A1. It might be this action, or this action, or this action, or this action, whatever. So effectively, you cannot apply it to the original object. You cannot take the original object. So you make a copy. Copy. Now the question is, how do you typically copy an object? What happens during object copy? Now, if you have a typical struct with like an int and a string and a vector as well, vector of, let's say, some other types, then in most cases, when you make a copy, this is a kind of member-wise copy. Which means everything is okay. You get a copy. You take up lots of memory. The only real problem is if you're not mutating strings, then storing strings makes copies of them. I make this cardinal sin as well. But at any rate, you manufacture a copy, and that's it. Unfortunately, if we go with the idea of allocations the way that they're sort of suggested in the heap sense, then oops. Then what we end up with is the following. So we end up with a structure. Oops. We end up with a structure which might have a shared pointer somewhere, shared PTR. Okay, foo. Okay, so unlike a unique pointer, you can actually copy this whole thing. You can copy the structure. You would have another copy of structure. So this is if this is instance A, then at some point you'll have instance B, which is exactly the same thing, and it has the shared PTR. Or at least I'm assuming that's the way it works. And the problem, of course, is that being a shared pointer, these both point to the same thing. Now, the problem with Monte Carlo simulations is you keep changing things. At each step, you keep changing things. So what you really want is you really want to have a proper copy. So you want somebody to manufacture an exact copy of foo. And you typically, if you had the sort of a desire to copy things that way, you would have to implement this yourself. You would have to go out and write code that would do this. So what we can do instead for each of the iterations of this simulation is we can pass copy by value. So whatever, if you have like a function that takes the let's call it next step, that calculates the nth iterate, let's say, then you can pass the whole game as a value. So this might seem really bad. I mean, game can be fairly big, not huge, but fairly big, but we end up making lots of copies. When we get to the final, the terminal stage, so let's suppose that C is the terminal stage. So somewhere at this point, there is a game that's been heavily modified. We've done lots of things to it. Now, unfortunately, what happens is that it's only at this point that we have to have an evaluation, that we evaluate our position. So we evaluate the final state of the game that we passed in. And it's very convenient because we don't have to backtrack. We don't have to do CQRS or whatever to actually, you know, wind back the stack. So we typically have a number for how successful this game is. And we also have a set of steps. So what we end up doing is we end up recording this and this and this. So we end up recording all the actions. They're actually recorded in a... let's see if I remember this correctly. It's a concurrent unordered map. No, concurrent unordered multi-map, I think. Multi-map. So we put this in a concurrent structure because effectively when you begin the simulation at your first step, what you typically have... Sorry about all the scribbling. What you typically have is... you typically have a loop that looks kind of something like this. So you have just a pragma parallel 4. And then you have a loop going through each of the possible first steps. So you have a set of actions. It could be like a vector of actions V. And then you go... unfortunately, you have to go with the old syntax. You cannot use range-based for in OpenMP, but you go along with the old idea. So you say int I equals, you know, 0, I is less than v dot size, and all the rest of it. So here you would typically simulate and get the result and put it in your... we actually send a reference to this concurrent ordered multi-map throughout the whole thing. So I hopefully this explains why all of these constraints take place. So the reason why God object is used is because basically if you build a hierarchy, you then have to manage the hierarchy and you have to do static and dynamic casts. And remember that what ends up happening in languages without reflection is the follows. So typically, if you're doing something like C sharp, then you can say, if card is creature, you can write stuff like that. If card is creature, you just cast it and do away with it. In C++, you typically say if dynamic cast creature pointer. Card, it all becomes a bit tedious. And not only that, but what ends up happening in the real world is typically if you have a class called card, then what you end up doing, just to simplify this process of checking, is you make an enum. You make an enum, you call it type, and here you put the different types like creature, spell, and so on. And then when you go and check the types, you don't use these crazy casts. You just look at the type. And if the type is correct, you just then you perform some sort of cast, maybe like a static cast or something, because you're sure that it is of the right type. So this certainly is one of the reasons why it's tedious. Another reason is that if you're storing things by value, then you're unable to store abstract classes, and you also have problems with the, even if it wasn't an abstract class, what you would end up storing is just the base information from the creature. So it's kind of non-polymorphic. Effectively. So pass by value is done because you need to replicate the state. And, you know, in a Monte Carlo simulation, you typically want to keep track of the state because sometimes the sequence of actions is impossible at a certain step. So you might think that you can do action A followed by action B, but it's possible that you can do action B, but be unable to perform action A simply because they only work in a particular order. So for this, we replicate the whole game state and we replicate basically everything. And so the use of the stack and not the heap is kind of sensible from the perspective that generally we don't in the kind of game state, what happens is you simulate lots of paths. So yes, it goes kind of to fairly extreme amounts, but after you're done with the simulation, after you're done with this, all you record is you record the steps. You record the steps here, plus you record the value of the position. So how good is a position here? Is it good or is it bad? So these are the two things that you record. And then what happens is these blue things, they get stored in your concurrent ordered multi-map, whatever. But the path and the temporary information that's been generated in this path is destroyed, because it's been allocated on the stack. Somebody came out and cleaned it up, and nobody cares about it anymore. So that's fine. So these three things, the idea of God object and the other stuff, but especially the God object idea, they got me thinking about as you know, one of the products I have is like a tool for converting Excel to code. So I thought, well, if you have a grid structure, then object-oriented programming is difficult. Because, I mean, if you have just a table full of things, like so, not UML, but literally a table with like a spreadsheet or something, how do you model object-oriented structures? Well, to some degree, it's actually possible. Because what we can do is we can take the extra dimension, like, for example, from one of these cells, and we can sort of splice it. So let's suppose that you're modeling a person. So a person might have let's say they have an age, they have hair color, and then they have names, and you can model this as a sort of class within class, or as an array. So this have names 0 and then 1, 2, 3 and so on, and then more fields here. Why would you want to do this in the first place? Well, one of the reasons why this kind of modeling is relevant is because there's lots of information that you have to generate even for a simple class. Now, if you have a simple class or a struct, which in C++ is just a class with all its things public, here are some of the things that you need to make. First of all, if we call it C, you need to initialize every field in C in the constructor. And the problem with this, of course, is that because we're doing a God object approach, there is lots of fields. There's fields and fields and fields and fields here. And the problem is you have to initialize one of each of them. So if it's like a Boolean field which says can do something, can do X, then you need to give it a value of false. Because what happens, and this is something that's unusual if you're like a .NET or a Java developer, is that otherwise these fields are going to have really crazy values. So you cannot be guaranteed that a false value, that a Boolean value is false by default. You cannot guarantee. So you need to generate this constructor and go for lengths and lengths and lengths. And it's annoying. So this is one of the problems where code generation can help. Next up is what happens when you want to output things. So remember, if you want to output things, you have to do like a friend ostream operator less, and then you have to output the stuff that you want. And once again, it's very tedious and it can be automated. And certainly the generators, if you look at a modern IDE like IntelliJ IDE or ReSharper, they generate the two-string implementation. So it's the same idea here. You need somebody to generate these things for you. So that's one of the things worth mentioning. Of course, another thing worth mentioning is initialize a list. So it's really great to be able to write like c.price equals and then curly braces and all the resources that you need for playing this particular card, for example. But unfortunately, this kind of assignment isn't given by default. So for example, if I have price as some kind of structure, like let's say I have class called basket and I have four ints A, B, C, D, then I cannot write this by default. I have to literally have a constructor called basket that takes an initialize list, initializer list of int. And here I have to write some truly nasty code in order to be able to take these values. And what happens if one of the values is missing, for example? I have to handle that as well. I really don't want to write this by hand. It's just such a boring thing to do. So that's another thing that you can generate. And of course, what typically happens is you have comparisons. So let's suppose we go with this basket and we want to say whether it's equal to some other basket B. And here we have to compare B.A with A, B.B with B, B.C with C, and so on. And it's once again lots of tedious stuff. And the same goes for like operators. So you can subtract these. If we do member-wise subtraction, if we think of it as a vector, A, B, C, D, then we want to subtract some other vector, D too. And this is the kind of stuff that, you know, writing it is just really boring and depressing. So this is where code generation from a structure like this comes into play, because suddenly you can generate really complicated structures that do huge amounts of stuff. So what is missing from this equation? Because some things have to be missing. I mean, if we could model object-oriented everything inside of a grid, we would. So some of the things that are tough are enums. So an enum would also have to be represented as, you know, a set of values. And the great thing about this is not only do you get an enum class, or just an enum without the class if you want, but in addition you get a generated toString method. So you would have something like string toString taking my enum and then doing the doing a switch statement on the enum and outputting the string. Now you can use boost to generate this. So boost has lots of pre-processing macros and they allow you to do stuff like this. But it's great if you can actually see it, because with boost you'll have lots of macros. I use those macros and they're not very beautiful, I must confess. So then of course if you have an enum for like gender, you have to have some way of associating these two. So you have to have some way of saying that this is not an int, but it's actually an enum. And here are the enum definitions. So that's one of the challenges. Another challenge, I guess, is here, for example, we've embedded a structure inside a structure. So it's two dimensional. But I can easily come up with a situation where this is not going to look good. Because imagine you have multiple levels of depth, for example. So imagine I have I have a structure that's horizontal, and then inside it I have another structure that's, this one's vertical, and it's containing, let's say, another class that's defined horizontally. And imagine that this class is defined horizontally, this class is defined, so we end up extending it like this. And then it's uncertain where you could extend it, because you are running out of space and you are. So this kind of idea of deep nesting doesn't work, which is why God objects rule. Because God objects, you can have some level of nesting, but it's typically limited. So typically in my case, you would have maybe a restriction at this level. So you would have this kind of idea. Okay, so another thing is the idea of transience and the idea of kind of selective persistence and all the rest of it. So imagine you're playing a computer game and you have a creature, let's put it here, and the creature has a certain amount of hit points, like 6 out of 15. Essentially, you might think of this as a set of values, and indeed, instead of hit points, you might have something else. And there's typically three sets of values that you need to track. And that's the initial value that the thing had originally, like the thing that was written on the card, for example, the current value and the maximum value. So if I have these, if I am indeed implementing these, then I would definitely end up having with a third construct. So let's suppose I'm embedding some type here, and that type is using this kind of notation. Then it would be sort of here, and also the same goes for the custom logic. So custom logic in classes is something you have to write by hand. And keep in mind that C++ does not have a partial keyword. So it might be a bit difficult to actually mix generated and predefined code. Generated and handwritten code, rather. So that's once again another challenge. Now, realistically, the kind of stuff that you can generate, and especially this kind of vector related generation, is very useful, because what it ends up doing is it ends up basically manufacturing all the scaffolding for you. For example, it can do encapsulation, which I typically don't do, which is why I have structs instead of classes, but you can do. So for example, for a given class, let's call it person, what it can do stuff like this. And here we come to the nastiness of compiler extensions and whatnot. So effectively, you can generate properties, for example. Now, properties are a bit difficult, a bit painful to generate, because essentially if you have age, for example, then the typical approach, if this is private, is to make public getters and setters. Public. So you have, like, for example, void set age. And you set age to some value, and you say simply age equals value. And then you can redefine it later if you want to prevent somebody from setting the age or something. And then you do compiler extension. So you can do that like decal spec property. And you can say that the setter is equal to set underscore age, and the same for the put as well. You can have some function, and all of this is called int, maybe age with a capital A to distinguish from the int with a small a. So you can do stuff like that, and it takes some time to write, but if you automate the process, then it becomes somewhat easier. And also lots of aggregate calculations that you might need. So for example, in many cases, I need to calculate the sum of fields. So if you have fields A, B, C, and D, I want to have a function that returns the sum. And I can actually, once again, use this kind of approach. So I can make a function, not a void returning function, but a function that returns an int. I can call it sum. And in here, after the return, we can generate, we can get the thing to generate the actual addition. And then, of course, we can also generate the decal spec. So in this case, the decal spec would simply return, it would basically say, I messed up a little here, because the set is in fact the put. And there is also a corresponding get. So in this case, you would write get equals sum, and you would call it int sum with a capital S, for example. Or you can change the names, put it underscore here, whatever. The point is that you can once again simplify these kinds of aggregate operations. And this is one of the reasons why we jump into things like template metaprogramming and whatever, because sometimes we want these things automatically, and it's impossible to actually do in the language. So that's where code generation from, particularly from this kind of structures, is actually viable. So that's basically all I wanted to mention. It's just an idea that came to mind, and I think it's a workable idea, because if you look at your code and if you see a certain amount of generality and simply, you know, data structures containing data structures without any particular logic in them, apart from maybe some of the logic that you might need, then this kind of approach is the way to go. So that's my thought of the day, so to speak.